So with the electrical issue taken care of here in the saltwater fish holding system, and the maintenance on the water purification system taken care of, it's now time to get into the leak in the bottom of the saltwater mixing container. So let's start with a little bit of cowbell, please. I had mentioned that the plywood that supports the container that holds the purified water appears to be wet, whereas the plywood that holds the saltwater mixing container is dry. Knowing that I had issues here once before, I'd have to assume that it's the same issue. So I think the first thing that we need to do is pump out that purified water over into the saltwater side so that we can ultimately pull that container out of there. Switch out the piece of plywood so I don't have to deal with it again, and try to find the hole in the bottom of that container and patch it.
To move the water over, I'll use my sump pump and a short hose. The Awaki pump that connects the two containers won't draw out the last 3 inches, so this is how I can completely empty this big container.
One of the things I can do while we're transferring the water over is we originally included these union ball valves, so I can close that valve there, close the one on the top of the water pump, as well as close the one here on the far side, and I can disconnect these union fittings, which will allow me to actually remove the water pump and the plumbing out of the system.
This plumbing arrangement allows me to move water from one container to the other. It's also what I use to mix the newly made salt water in the left-hand container. And eventually, once I get the plumbing secured, I'll be able to pump fresh or salt water to either my fish holding system behind me or out to the large container in my van.
But it'll probably behoove me to wait until the water level's down on the other side so I can open the valve and drain the water out of the line first without making a big mess out here.
By closing the valve and then placing a bucket under the water pump, I can now loosen the union and catch all the spillage. From there, I can loosen the unions that connect the two 300-gallon containers and get those out of the way. There is a union fitting on the water pump's discharge side that, once loosened and unplugged, will get the water pump also out of the way.
So I've managed to remove the plumbing that connects all the containers together as well as the water pump. And this particular line is on a piece of flex tubing, so that'll bend out of the way. So now what I need to do is disconnect the electrical and the input from the purification system.
The pure water line easily disconnects from the solenoid valve, and the power supply and pump's timer are then unplugged from the power strip. With that, it's a big hee-ho. Maybe a second bigger hee-ho. Okay. Okay. Now on to the cart.
So with the container pulled away, right off the bat we can tell that wherever the leak is from is from the front half of where the container sits on the plywood. Second thing is, you can see here spots where previously the termites had bored through the wood, and then in my last attempt I had tried to squirt silicone down inside there, but you can also see here new termite turds, I guess you would call them, or the results of boring termites in the wood. Those are the shavings or whatever they poop out. There appears to be, that could be a new one there, a lot of shavings over in this area here where I previously put silicone, and then there is a new tunnel there. So any one of those could be potentially where they're boring through. So at this point, I have a bunch of stored lumber here in the front yard. Try to cover it up so it looks semi, not unattractive. Yeah, I have some plywood here. Here's a 4x4 sheet of 3/4 inch plywood. In fact, it happens to be painted as well. So I'm going to end up pulling out this board. Too many times now I've had problems with it. And replace it with the new one. So that's the first thing we need to do. Second thing we'll do is wheel the container out into the driveway and try to find out where the hole in the bottom of it is. In fact, maybe I should do that now, because the solution would be, again, more silicone placed on the inside and allowed to dry in time for placing back here on top of the new plywood top. So let's get to it.
And once again, another hee-ho. And maybe another hee-ho again.
Well, you can see, or maybe you can't see, there's no real obvious holes there. There's a few spots that the silicone has come a little bit loose, but I've also got silicone on the inside. So I'm not sure if that's a spot there that could certainly use a new dab. At the very least, I've got this out. We can allow it to dry out, because again, silicone won't stick to a wet surface. So that's out. It's now time to get the new plywood board put in place, or should I say, get the old one taken out.
This particular 4x4 sheet of 3/4 inch plywood has been in this spot for the last 12 to 13 years. Somewhere along the line, it picked up what I believe are termites. The smart thing to do is to replace it. And since there's no other signs of termites in the board next to it, I'm just going to replace just this one piece of wood.
So I had to make a little notch in the corner of the plywood to accommodate that vent pipe for part of the fish system. So now with the platform, or the cement blocks in place, I think I'm ready to position the new plywood platform.
This new 4x4 sheet of plywood was from the old jellyfish breeding system. So not only is it already paid for, but it's painted as well. And I think this version of recycling is actually an upgrade.
Okay, so the plywood fit snugly into place, and I think that part of it's taken care of. So now what I need to do is start working on the container, try to figure out where its holes are. So I'll see you in the next half.
Would you like to reduce your nitrate and phosphate as well as algae problems? Consider the Turbo's Aquatics LED Algae Scrubber line, which consists of the L2, L3, and L4 models. All units include dual drain system, slotted pipe, growth screen, bulkheads, and dual high-quality growth spectrum optimized LED lights and heat sinks. The L-Series algae scrubbers are easily installed and externally mounted either above the aquarium or placed over your existing filter system. Control aquarium nutrients naturally using algaes. For more information, visit turbosaquatics.com. Do you have an aquarium question? Are you looking for aquatic answers? Just key in wetwebmedia.com. WetWeb Media has information on freshwater, marine, brackish, and planted aquariums. WetWeb Media is staffed by the capable WetWeb Media crew. Check today's facts, ask questions, or search keywords. That's wetwebmedia.com.
So I've located a number of potential holes, as well as some previous ones that need to be redone. The process will be go in there and identify them, and then go through and sand them down to create a bit of a rough surface so that I can apply the silicone. At least the silicone has a place to stick to. Now, there's one thing that I did do, and that was I went inside here and looked at the patches I had made from the inside. They appear to be firm and into place. I would be hesitant to take them to scratch off the old stuff and try to do it again. They again seem to be okay as they are. Maybe I'm making a mistake, but I think I feel comfortable about it at the moment. So let's go ahead and sand these areas a little bit.
I'm using sandpaper not to smoothen the surface, but actually to rough up the surface. The idea being a rough surface has more for the silicone to grab onto. Keep in mind, silicone really is not an adhesive, but rather a more of a pliable holdfast. The more surface area it covers, the better its ability to grab onto that surface area.
Now that I've got those holes kind of roughed up, at least at the surface, I'm going to take this can of compressed air, go through and blow out, try to get any loose debris out of the little holes. So now that I got the surface around those holes roughed up and the debris blown out within the hole, it's time to patch them. To me, the patch would be a silicone. And the thing you need to remember about silicone is you want to use 100% silicone sealant. None of these that have BioGuard or bioactivated this or repel that. Again, 100% silicone sealant, typically the clear version, although I think they offer a black and a white. So I'm going to take and apply this over the holes. Now again, I'm patching it from the outside based on the belief that the patches I've done previously on the inside, which are still holding really firmly, are doing the job, and that my problem recently was a new hole, like maybe that one in the middle or that new one there just underneath the top of the outlet pipe. So I'm going to go ahead and apply this now.
As I apply the silicone, I press downwards, forcing it to push out any air between it and the surface, as well as to give it a much better chance to grab into that roughened plastic surface.
So now with the silicone in place, I went through and kind of pushed it down to make sure that the air bubbles were out. It's just a matter of time waiting for the silicone to cure, which usually should take about 24 hours, but it should skin up pretty quick, but we've got some time. We've allowed the silicone to dry overnight. And it's my hope that the patches that we've done with that silicone will have resolved any of the leak issues. Not only did I redo some of the previous ones, but there appeared to be a few new ones, which I suspect were the recent results of the leak. So anyhow, I haven't water tested this. Maybe that's a mistake, but I'm ready to lift it up into place.
And with that said, it's a big hee-ho. Well, maybe a second bigger hee-ho. Okay, now, onto the platform.
So with the container slid onto the new platform, I think now is time to hook it up. The starting point will be the pipe that crosses between here. That way the two containers get positioned properly and equally.
And as easy as they came off before, they now reassemble just as easily. These two connect the containers together, and this connects the inlet of the water pump. And this threads on to the discharge pipe.
And feeling pretty comfortable in where they're located, we'll go through with a monkey wrench and tighten up those union fittings just a little bit more than hand tight. Now you hook up the electrical and the water lines. So with all the fittings and the water pump now put in position and tightened, the electrical's hooked up for the water pump. I guess I'm just hoping that my patches worked out well. They wasn't that big a leakage before, but it was enough to kind of bother me. Now, at this point, I guess what we can do is turn on the water purification system, but I would assume that to get an idea as to quickly whether we've solved the problem or not, we could run some of that water across here back into that container and wait a little bit, see if we get any leakage. But at this point, I'm going to assume that I have taken care of the situation. So with the twist of a valve, I should be back to manufacturing ultra pure water with that Spectra Pure Max Cap 180 RODI water purification system. With the use of my voltmeter and some simple deduction, we were able to determine the source of the electrical issue over in the fish holding system and have now resolved that. And if I've done a good job in patching with the silicone in the bottom of the water container, I should be able to get back to making some salt water for aquarium service customers. I've got another project I need to jump into, which is rebuilding that jellyfish breeding system. But that's another story. And so as I do, you should as well. Always keep moving forward.